antes de mientras tanto. So now we start.
Good evening. We will have a brief recap of what we did last time, and we will continue that. See, two or three important things which electrochemistry is. The variables are very limited. I have already talked about it number of times. Now also I am repeating. It is only potential versus current. That is the most immediate variable that we can study. We can also study as a function of time, as a function of concentration and all that, but most of the studies in basic electrochemistry is I as the Y variable, E as the independent variable. So I versus E curves only is what is happening. In this generation of the I versus E curves, there are certain very valid information that we can obtain from the I versus E curves. I versus T curves also is possible, but anyway, the most of the measurements are I versus E curves. Now, there are, as I told you, there are number of techniques. Okay, we will try to summarize them in one projection. More than 120 experiments are possible, or techniques are possible, just like cyclic voltammetry, chronoamperometry, chronopotentiometry, like that. Okay, we can go on putting that. We will not. Essentially, what it means is potentiometry and current measurements. That is all. Potential measurement and current measurements. The current measurements and potential measurements can be done in number of ways. Especially the potential can be stepwise function, continuous variation function, pulsed potential function, like that we can go on. So therefore, the techniques are now multiplying if we are going on varying the way we will be impressing the potential. So therefore, all these techniques more or less have got certain criterion. If we get a certain type of trace, then it means something. We are going to see at least one or two techniques we will take, and we will see. So these are all called the criterion for the process. If I get, for example, is it a reversible process or irreversible process, or partially reversible process, partially irreversible process, all those things, even from the very recording the I versus E curves or E versus I curves, we will be able to say something on this. We can even say beyond this, we are going to see all of them. From the slopes of the curve or from the variations of the curve, we will be able to say many things about the process. So what we have so far done is we initially set up electrochemical cell, and the notations that are followed, anode and cathode, positive and negative, like that. Many notations are possible, but anyway, we will not worry about all of them. What we talked about it is electrochemical cells. It can be concentration cell, it can be active cell, passive cell, many things. The electrodes also is not only anode and cathode, ideally polarized electrode, ideally non-polarizing electrode, all those things we have seen. Now, when we have an electrode dipped in an electrolyte, then there is an interface, electrode-electrolyte interface. This interface can be imagined as a capacitor, or diffuse double layer, or many other models that we have seen. Now, we are in the process of electron transfer at the electrode surface. Now, the kinetics of the electron transfer. The kinetics of the electron transfer at the electrode are governed by certain equations. One of them is the Butler-Walmer equation. As I told you, the electrode can be rotating electrode, or dropping mercury electrode or passive electrodes like platinum or anything. So therefore, if depending upon the nature of the electrode, the current voltage curves can be described by some equations. So now we are going to see some of them. We have already seen this in the last time, so we will quickly look at it. So this is the Butler-Walmer equation. Butler-Walmer equation is current due to the anode and current due to the cathode. I is the electrode current and amperes. I0 is the exchange current density. Exchange current density I0 is not equal to zero. It is I0 is equal to IA when it is when IA and IC are equal, then that is I0. E is the electrode potential. E equilibrium is the equilibrium potential. A is the electrode area in square meters. T is absolute temperature. N is the number of electrons. F is Faraday. R universal gas constant. Alpha is the so-called symmetry factor or charge transfer coefficients, dimensionless. The equation is named after the Butler and Walmer. While Butler-Walmer equation is valid for over the full potential range, simpler approximate solutions can be obtained for more restricted ranges of potential. Okay, as over potential is either positive or negative becomes larger than 0.5 volts, the second and the first term of the equation becomes negligible respectively. Hence, simply exponential relationship between current and over potential are obtained, or the over potential can be considered as logarithmically dependent on the current density. This theoretical result is in agreement with the experimental findings of the German physical chemist called Julius Tafel, and the usual plots of over potential versus log current density are known as the Tafel plots. So this is like this, we will have many plots, we will come to it, many of them. So the, one of them is the Tafel plot, which is a common phenomenon in electrochemistry. The slope of the Tafel plot reveals the value of the transfer coefficient alpha for the given direction of the electrode reaction. The Tafel plot can be for anode for or for cathode. We will see that in a minute. So therefore, I anode is I0 into exponential when the second term in the Butler-Walmer equation, the second term is negligible, then it is is the first term. First term is anode, second term is the cathode. So IA, the anode current, is I0 exponential 1 minus alpha NF NA, number of electrons in the anode reaction by RT at high anodic over potential. IC is equal to I0. I0 is the exchange current density, exponential minus alpha NF eta C by RT at cathodic over potential, at high cathodic over potentials. Because at very, very low, 0.05 volts, the cathodic potential will not be increasing very much. It will increase linearly. This we will show this in a minute. These equations can be rearranged to give the Tafel equation, which was obtained experimentally. So therefore, the Tafel equation is eta C, the over potential of the cathode reaction is given by logarithm of IC. In the same way, eta A, over potential for the anode is logarithm of anode. So eta is, this is a constant, I0 is a constant exchange current density, all these things are constant, therefore A plus B logarithm of I. A is this and B is this. A is the 0.059 alpha A n logarithm of I0, and B is 0.0059 by alpha into n. The Tafel slope is an intensive property and does not depend upon the electrode surface area. I0 is an extensive parameter, is influenced by the electrode surface area, the kinetics and the speed of the reaction. Notice that the Tafel slope is restricted to number of electrons n involved in the charge transfer control reaction and the so-called symmetry factor. I hope you are able to see alpha and n are involved in both A and B. It is n is often is equal to 1, although the symmetry factor can vary from 0 to 1. Normally it is close to 0.5. This means that the steeper slope should be close to 120 millivolts if n is equal to 1 and 60 millivolts to when n is equal to 2. So this is what we are saying as criterion. So this the value of the slope itself tells you the number of electrons that are transferred in the electrochemical kinetic reaction. So therefore, here we are showing the current versus potential plot. So A, B, C, or all of them are different E minus E equilibrium values. So the for example, A is very, very low E by E equilibrium, B is middle, and C is very high E power potential equations. So the Tafel equation can be rewritten. I is equal to NFK into all these things. The plus sign of the equipment refers to anodic and the minus sign to a cathodic reaction. N is the number of electrons involved. In the electrode kinetic reaction, K is the rate constant for the reaction. Okay. So therefore, we have already written this equation. We are only repeating it. Eta, the over potential is A plus B logarithm of I. A is going to be dependent upon logarithm of I zero. N is the over potential, eta is the over potential, I is the current density, A and B are Tafel constants. The applicability, when an electrochemical reaction occurs in two half reactions on separate electrodes, the Tafel equation is applied to each electrode separately. We can separately anode reaction, we have already told that anode reaction, cathode reaction. Tafel plot for anode, for cathode, Tafel plot for anode. The Tafel equation assumes the reverse reaction rate is negligible compared to the forward reaction rate. The Tafel equation is applicable to the region where the values of the polarization are high. At low values of polarization, the dependence of current and polarization is usually linear, not logarithmic. We have seen this. It is linear here. Here only it is exponential or logarithmic. The linear region is called the polarization resistance due to its formal similarity to Ohm's law. The exchange current is the current at equilibrium, the rate at which oxidized and reduced species transfer electrons with the electrode. In other words, the exchange current density is the rate of the reaction at reversible potential, when the over potential is zero by definition. At the reversible potential, the reaction is in equilibrium, meaning that the forward and reverse reactions progress at the same rates. This rate is called the exchange current density. The current measured at this potential is called the exchange current density. The Tafel slope, we have already talked about it, is the only repetition. That slope, Tafel slope, not to intercept, Tafel slope is 2.303 RT by alpha F. So now, instead of this, we are going to look at the variations of the electrodes. One of them is called the rotating disk electrode. Now, when we take rotating disk electrode, what happens here is the concentration at the disk surface is remaining constant, whereas the rotation speeds are giving rise to the fluctuations in the concentrations in the bulk. So therefore, this equation, the equation applicable to rotating electrode system is called the Levitch equation. It is normally done at a highly high speed of the rotating disk electrode of the order of thousands of revolutions per minute, but at very low scan rate. The potential has to be scanned. It should be 2 to 5 millivolts per second. Whereas in some other experiments, it will be 20, 30, 50, 100 millivolts per second. It is important to remember that in order to determine the diffusion current and the mass transfer coefficient using voltammetry, excess inert supporting electrolyte must be present to eliminate the migration current. This we have already talked about it. So migration current has to be suppressed only when we are measuring the diffusion current. It is done by applying very high concentration of the supporting electrolyte. The Levitch equation, we are giving the equation, we are going to see what is the, how to write this equation, 0.620 NFA D to the power of 2 by 3 W to the power of half V to the power of 1 by 6 minus 1 by 6 C, where IL is the Levitch current, N is the number of electrons, F is Faraday, electrode area is A, D is the diffusion quotient, omega is the angular rotation rate of the electrode, V is the kinematic viscosity, C is the concentration. It is important to note that layer of the solution immediately adjacent to the surface of the electrode behaves as if it was stuck to the electrode, while the bulk of the solution is being stirred vigorously by the rotating electrode, that this thin layer of the solution manages to cling to the surface of the electrode and appears to be motionless. This layer is called the stagnant layer in order to distinguish it from remaining bulk of the solution. The act of the rotation drags material to the electrode surface where it can react. Providing the rotation speed is kept within the limits, the laminar flow is maintained, then the mass transfer equation is given by the Levitch equation. Mass transfer equation is the electrochemical reaction. So this is the Levitch equation. We will not repeat it again. So normally the current voltage curves, okay, the potential is plotted at the x-axis and current is plotted y-axis. Current microamperes versus potentials millivolts, okay, 0 millivolt, 100 millivolt, 200, 300, 400, 500 millivolts. Forward and reverse traces are on top of each other. This is there if it is a reversible reaction. Now, if I were to plot the limiting current, this is the limiting current here. This is the limiting current and this is the charging current. So therefore, the diffusion current is the difference between the charging current and the limiting current. So if I were to look at the limiting current versus omega, the electrode rotational velocity, if it is a linear thing, then this Levitch equation can be applied. This is one of the criterion. Okay. Kinetic velocity is the ratio of the absolute viscosity of a solution to its density. Ratio. Okay. Absolute viscosity is measured in points. Kinematic viscosity is measured in strokes. Now, today we are going to see cyclic voltammetry. Okay. This is what we did the last time. We have quickly So we are going to look at the cyclic voltammetry. Cyclic voltammetry is carried out as on a stationary electrode. We have seen rotating disc electrode, dropping mercury electrode and all that. If the electrode were to be stationary, a metallic electrode like platinum wire or something like that, then it is called, and then the potential is cycled, then it is cyclic voltammetry. This is normally involves the use of an inert disc electrode made of platinum, gold or glassy carbon. Nickel has also been used. Now the general thing is platinum is generally used in practice things. In very good cyclic voltammetry experiments and other things have to be done glassy carbon electrode. You will see what is glassy carbon and things. It is a mirror like carbon. The potential is continuously changed as a linear function of time. The rate of change of potential with the time is referred to as the scan rate, nu. Compared to the RDE, the scan rates in cyclic voltammetry are usually much higher, typically 50 millivolts per second. We have already seen in RDE measurements, the scan rate, the potential scan rate is 2 to 5 millivolts per second. Here it is 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, even 100 millivolts per second. We'll see why it is so. Cyclic voltammetry in which the direction of the potential is reversed at the end of the first scan, thus the waveform is usually of the form of an isosceles triangle. I will show you in a minute. The advantage using a stationary electrode is that the product of the electron transfer reaction that occurred in the forward scan can be probed again in the reverse scan. For example, an oxidation reaction is taking place in the reverse direction, the reduction reaction, the corresponding reduction reaction will be taking place. Cyclic voltammetry is a powerful tool for determination of formal redox potentials. Okay, we will see the what is formal redox potential. Okay, redox potential, standard redox potential, formal redox potential, all those things must be distinguished. Anyway, we will have time to do that, but in here, since we are introducing the formal redox potential, we will tell you. For example, E0 is the standard reduction potential. Formal redox potential is E0 plus some terms. Something like the involving the activity quotients and all those things. We will explicitly we will look at the formal redox potential and the standard reduction potentials separately. When the standard reduction potentials, the activity is unity. The formal redox potential is it is at a formal concentration. Direction of chemical reactions that proceed or follow electrochemical reaction and evaluation of the transfer kinetics is all possible with the cyclic voltammetry. We are going to do that. This is what is happening. So the potential is now, I hope you are able to see, potential is increase, then it is decrease and gone in the negative direction and got. This is the cyclic voltammetry trace. So cyclic voltammetry is normally done cyclic comparison of voltammetry to other electrochemical methods. Voltammetry, electrochemical method in which information about an analyte, okay, we will see depolarizer or electrochemically active species is obtained by measuring current as a function of applied potential. I have repeatedly told that in electrochemical measurements, what you are measuring is the Y is current and the X parameter is applied potential. Only a small amount of the analyte or the depolarizer is used. High concentration of the supporting electrolyte is used. Now, in all these measurements, in potentiometry and other things, you are always using a two electrode system, but in the cyclic voltammetry, it should be used as a three electrode system. We will come to it why three electrode and other things we will do. But anyway, we will first of all name them and then look at them. Working electrode, this is the electrode on which the electrochemical reaction is taking place. Micro electrode, whose potential is varied with the time. Reference electrode, potential remains constant. The reference electrode, its potential remains constant, but so that we can measure the actual potential that is impressed on the working electrode. If I were to measure the potential between the working electrode and reference electrode, the reference electrode is a constant potential. Therefore, we know very well what is the potential that is impressed upon the working electrode. Counter electrode is normally mercury or platinum that completes the circuit. Conducts electron from signal source through solution to the working electrode. Supporting electrolyte, we have already talked about it. Excess non-reactive. Non-reactive means in the potential range in which we are measuring. I have already told you the potential range in always is up to 2 volts. Not to many of the reactions are taking place below 1.5 volts. So that is what, whereas if I have alkali metal, potassium and other things, we have already seen this, potassium and the sodium, they are all having the reduction potential of the order of nearly lithium, for example, lithium is having 3 volts, so sodium and potassium are having around 2.5, 2.6 volts. So therefore, in the electrochemical measurements, when we are using these electrolytes, they are not undergoing electrochemical reaction. That is sodium ions or sodium metal or potassium ions or potassium. So applied potential is linear with time. Okay, it is linearly varied with respect to time. When I measure the current versus potential, we have already told sigmoid curve or S-shaped curve will come. Now the potentiometry measure potential of a sample or a system at or near zero current. Potentiometry at normally done as a zero current, net current as a function of potential. Voltammetry measure current as a change in potential. coulometry use of all the analyte in the process of measurement at fixed for current or potential. Voltammetry uses only small amount of analyte while vary potential. Voltammetry first reported in 1922 by Czech chemist Hejrovský. Okay, he is the inventor of the polarography, later given the Nobel Prize for the method. Excitation source, potential set up by instrument. Okay, we will come to it. What is the, that is why he called it is potentiostat. Okay, working electrode establishes concentration of reduced or oxidized species at the electrode based on Nernst equation. We have already talked about Nernst equation. E is equal to E zero minus RT by NF logarithm of A reduced by A oxidized or A oxidized by A reduced. So the here we are showing the concentration, bulk concentration is this distance from the electrode is what is shown here. So the concentration will be uniform. But at the when I apply a potential, the concentration of the solution, concentration of the species at the electrode and with respect to the distance of the electrode, how it will vary, it is all shown here. So these curves are, when I increase the time, the concentration will be initially with very low time, it will be like this. Then at a sufficient time, the concentration will be varying like this. So current is just a measure of the rate at which a species can be brought to the electrode surface. Now, the concentration to the electrode surface can be brought in two ways. One is stirred, hydrodynamic voltammetry, and stirred, that is the polarography, dropping mercury electrode. Okay, so here we have having the electrode here. The dotted blue line is the double Nernst diffusion layer of stagnant solution, then the laminar flow, then the turbulent flow in the bulk of the solution. So the three modes of transport of the species to the electrode surface, we have already talked about it, migration, convection, and diffusion, how to make them, the each one of them when a particular experiment is shown here. So analyte selectivity is provided by the applied potential on working electrode. We have already seen that suppose if I were to take lead plus lead 2 plus ions to get as lead, the potential that I have to apply will be minus 0.13 reduction reaction, therefore minus. Potassium plus electron giving rise to the standard reduction potential is minus 2.93 versus NHE, normal hydrogen electrode. We will come to it, what is NHE, SHE and all those things. So therefore, so this is the reason why I have already talked about potassium, sodium and lithium. They are all having reduction standard reduction potentials very near to zero. Electroactive species in the sample solution are drawn towards the working electrode where half cell redox reaction takes place. Another corresponding half cell reaction will also take place at the counter electrode to complete the electron flow. The resultant current flowing through the electrochemical cell reflects the activity, that is the concentration of the electroactive species involved. This is why the electrochemical measurements are very important. You are able to determine concentrations are very low, very low. Okay, up to 20 years back or 10 years back, the lowest concentrations, if I have to determine, I was using the, normally one will be using the electrochemical measurements. Electrochemical measurements can give rise to, for example, titrometry will give you normality, one normal, point one normal, point two, like that. Now, if I want to have nanomolar quantities, molar quantities, titration. Nanomolar quantities or micromolar quantities, it is electrochemical measurement. Now, micromolar to millimolar concentrations, other methods, okay, are possible. So therefore, the electrochemical measurements are pushing the concentration to their nanomolar limits. That is why the resultant current flowing through the electrochemical cell reflects the activity, that is the concentration of the electroactive species. Electroactive species is what we call as the depolarizer. So you can see here, when I have 1 volt impressed on versus SCE, we have all so far done is versus NHE. Now it is versus SCE, standard Columbell electrode. 1 volt we are applying, therefore it is what is the actual voltage of the electrode? It is measured with respect to standard Columbell electrode. Whereas when we measure it with respect to NHE, it is the absolute value. We will come to it, what is the standard hydrogen electrode value and standard Columbell electrode value. So now if I were to take the lead 2 plus ions getting deposited in a concentration of potassium ions, you can see how the lead 2 plus ions are diffusing to the electrode through the medium of the potassium plus ions. So you can see lead migrate to the electrode via diffusion. So when so at the electrode supplies, E applied will be equal to E0 minus logarithm of RT by NF, M reduced by M oxidized at the electrode surface. I hope you are able to. The E is the applied potential. When if E applied is equal to E0, then zero, this will be zero, will be equal to 0.592 by N logarithm of M reduced species by M oxidized species. It will be minus if it is an. So minus M oxidized will be equal to M reduced at this thing. So potential, we have already shown this, potential is linearly varying. Current is varying the sigmoid way. So when we apply a potential, keeping the concentration constant, when we apply this curve also, we are shown. Here we have shown these curves. When you apply a potential, how it varies. So there are in the red at various concentrations at various times. So now in the thing, okay, they say same only is shown here. Okay. So this is similar time. So the blue region is the NERNst diffusion layer. This is the bulk concentration. So current generated at the electrode by this process is proportional to the concentration at the surface, which in turn is equal to the bulk concentration. For planar electrode, measured current I will be equal to NFA dA by DCA by DX. Okay. It is not very clearly written here, but it is a number. Okay, DCA by D, that is the slope of the curve between C bulk concentration to surface concentration. Okay, that is what we are putting here. N is the number of electrons in the off-cell reaction. F is the Faraday. A is the electrode area. D is the diffusion coefficient. So if as time increases, so you can see with the potential is increasing like this, or the potential can be increasing like a pulse. Okay, this is what is the variations that are possible. Even though we are measuring only I versus E, how I can apply is a variable parameter. So now we have to know this diffusion layer, because we are measuring all these things in the diffusion layer. This diffusion layer D must be very small, of the order of 10 to the minus 3 centimeters, or even less than that. How we'll get that D is the question. I will be equal to NF AD by delta into C oxidized species bulk minus C oxidized species at the surface. The delta is the thickness of the double layer. The largest slope, higher current will occur if E applied is very much less than E zero. Then this is the thing where K is this. K is the NF AD by delta. And so I will be equal to K into C. Therefore, the current is proportional to the bulk concentration. Also, as solution is stirred, delta decreases and I increases. That is why we have to see whether the diffusion layer will be smaller in the, if it is a stirred situation. Diffusion layer will be higher if it is a stationary system. Okay, we will stop at this point. This will give you only one picture of the cyclic Voltaire ram. So now this is the potential applied on the working electrode is usually swept over scan rate at a predetermined range of applied potential, minus 0.22 plus 0.2. Minus 1.4 electrons. The reduction we are looking, not oxidation. Okay, so that is why the potential is in the negative direction. So now this is the charging current. This is the limiting current. The limiting current minus the charging current is the diffusion current. So the cadmium ions, that all the cadmium ions at the electrode already have been reduced. That is why it remains constant. Current at the electrode becomes limited by diffusion current rate of cadmium 2 plus ions from the bulk of the solution to the electrode. The current slopes rising and levels off at a plateau. Then the potential corresponding to ID by 2 is called the E half. This is another characteristic parameter. The baseline is the residual current. We already talked about it, or capacitant current. So from this, we have to look at the cyclic Voltaire ram. Okay, like this. We will be taking it up to next presentation, and what information we can get out of this cyclic Voltaire ram, we will do next time. So if you have any questions, you can ask now. Essentially, what we have done or what we are trying to do is to understand all the electrochemical measurements as a plot of I versus E. And when we plot I versus E, what information or what deductions can be made? What all deductions, okay, what deduction can be made is not correct. What all deductions can be made is what we are trying to do. In one stroke, we are trying to understand the whole of the thing. Any questions? Okay, if you are not having any questions, you can go through them leisurely. I have already forwarded today's presentation to you. You can leisurely look at them. So next Wednesday, we will again look at the in detail about the cyclic voltammeter.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, Sir, actually, that one slide I want to, I'm confused more. I want to ask. Sir, this actually in CV actually that regarding rotating discs you told, and if somebody don't rotate the disc in place of rotating disc, if somebody rotate the solution itself, so how it will affect the diffusion length and like migrate and. And sir, this slide of this slide number, this cadmium one, sir, slide, I again want to understand, sir.
Okay. Okay, the question is, first we will answer this question, then we will come to the two questions by Honey and because. First question is, the question is, what will happen if I were to stir the solution? That is all. Because when you rotate the speed, rotate your electrode, only you are changing the concentration very near to the electrode. Not bulk of the solution is not as stirred. When you are stirring the solution, you are making the bulk of the solution. Therefore, the convection current is what you are measuring, not the diffusion current. Okay. Therefore, electrochemical measurements are done only for the electrode reaction has to be controlling their thing. Therefore, it is better to make the electrode reaction the slowest reaction so that you can study the kinetics of the electrode reactions. When you want to do the electrode reactions, you have to make the diffusion as the controlling step. If it is by the convection and other things, it is measuring the bulk concentration. So we will see later on when we do the cyclic voltammetry, that will be an instantaneous process. So we will not be able to measure the actual concentrations. There will be small error in the actual concentrations. If it is diffusion current, then it will be measuring the bulk concentration in terms of the diffusion current. Okay, this is the first question. I will come to that slide, the cadmium reduction slide, polarography. It is a polarographic experiment. So we will show that slide in a minute. Before that, we will answer the two questions that have been asked. What is formal potential of analyte and how is it determined by CV? The formal potential of of an analyte. Analyte is the electrochemical active substance. Okay, that is all. Is normally done by potentiometry, not cyclic voltammetry. But if you are very, very, it is coming from the Nernst equation. We will have opportunity to talk about it. See, Nernst equation. If E is equal to E zero minus RT by NF logarithm of reduced species by oxidized species. Now concentration only we are plotting. If we have to plot E is equal to E zero minus RT by NF logarithm of A activity of the reduced species by A activity of the oxidized species. In the A term, if I were to now substitute concentration, then there is an activity quotient term. So therefore, the formal potential is E zero minus RT by NF logarithm of the activity quotient of the reduced species by the activity quotient of the reduced species by the activity quotient of the oxidized species. This is the whole thing is called the E zero, because we are only talking about concentration terms. So E zero is not that. E zero is when A is one, when activity is equal to concentration. When we are substituting concentration, the activity quotient terms have to be there. I will in the next time I will write the equations in a explicit form and to show it to you. Therefore, E zero is the standard reduction potential when A is unity. When A is not unity, then E is equal to E zero, which is the formal potential, minus RT by NF logarithm of concentration of the reduced species by the concentration of oxidized species. The when the activity is not unity, then this formal potential comes. Then why Leavitt equation is valid up to laminar flow or streamline flow? What will happen if the flow becomes turbulent? Okay. When the flow becomes turbulent, the current will not be uniformly varying. Okay, we will have opportunity to talk about it. So in the electrochemical measurements, we are not measuring it, as I told you, either in the stationary electrode or electrode which is under our control, rotating disk electrode or the dropping mercury electrode like that. So under those conditions only we can measure, because we are measuring the concentration of the species at the electrode surface, not at the bulk of the solution. So therefore, normally electrochemistry experiments will not be done under turbulent flow. Now I will try to show this cadmium reduction potential.
No, sir, one more question is there before, sir.
Yes, tell me.
In that voltammetry slide, sir, first person who is reported, Harry Walsh, there actually you have shown for iron, that iron is reducing and forming Fe2+. That graph actually, when we are applying potential, concentration versus distance from the electrode. First graph is bulk concentration of iron, that is constant with respect to electrode. And when we apply a potential, there are so many graphs, means applying a potential, it is going from zero to bulk, attending the bulk by increasing the distance from the electrode, sir.
Okay, what is the question?
Sir, I want to understand, sir, like it's like this experiment is going on like rotated disk electrode. So like if I'm going far from the electrode actually, so that bulk concentration is again attending, and which is nearer to the electrode, that that iron Fe3+ ion are reducing to form Fe2+. So that's why concentration is going to be increased of Fe3+ when we are going far from electrode actually. But if the same case, if we rotate the solution, then like only bulk concentration will be there. There should not be graph like this.
Why? Even in the rotating disk electrode, the concentration that is monitored is very near to the electrode only. In the stationary electrode also, it is very near to the concentration. Only the problem is the distance of the diffuse double layer is very small in the rotating disk, whereas in the stationary electrode it will be of the order of 10⁻³ cm or something like that. Whereas in the rotating disk electrode, the diffuse layer will be of the order of 10 angstroms or 20 microns or 1 micron like that.
So, sir, it will be nearly, sir, actually I am asking that if, like you told him, right, if somebody don't rotate the disk, in place of that, if solution will be rotated. Sir, in that case, I want to see if this graph.
Rotation of the solution is not done in electrochemistry. Okay.
Yes, sir, that's right. If somebody will do, then like there should not be any change. Now only bulk concentration, like a straight line, you will get.
No. That is wrong. No. Because we have to make the. Okay, I will tell you the answer. Like the, if the electrochemistry is measuring the electrode kinetics, so electrode kinetics.
Yes, sir, that I understood. You should like it should be steady state like, which is very nearer to the electrode, and it should slow and steady. Motion will be diffusion motion will be somewhat slow and steady near the electrode. Like you want to say that, sir?
Yes.
That's why I said like. But when we going for like solution in solution, if you are rotating the solution, it's not like nearer to the electrode. It's like whole solution I am taking. So in that case, actually in that case, I want to see if I compare the graph, like I won't get this parabolic shape, like directly like bulk concentration only I'll get, like straight line.
Yes, straight line only will get.
Nothing will reduce, because either the amount which is reduced is very less.
No, no, I will show it to you. I have shown it to you, but maybe it is not very clearly seen. You look at this, this is what will happen. The first line, okay, the first line, you can see that it is this line, okay, it is varying very much. The first line is what will happen if you are stirring the solution. When you are not stirring the solution, the curves will be like this.
Okay.
So when the curves are like this sigmoid curve, then only we can analyze them. If it is going to be a rectangular curve, we cannot analyze them.
Okay.
We can analyze them, but we will not get accurate values. I hope you are able to see that.
Yes, sir. And like earlier that before that one slide is there, sir. That observed current change versus applied potential, and when there is two graphs are there, potential versus time and current versus potential, sir.
Okay. Here.
So, sir, that graph observed current change with applied potential. Generally, like when we apply current and potential, that is following Ohm's law, so it should go like first straight and then it should not hold. But here, like sigmoidal curve is coming. So why it is that means? Ohm's law, like either means after a certain limit Ohm's law, then like we will get some up downs curve. But here it's still proving current potential. We are getting some sigmoidal means from earlier stage no current is there. After certain limit it is started suddenly, and then it will get accurate.
Okay, what you are saying is the plot must be only. It should, the current should increase and steadily asymptotically saturating. That is what you are saying.
Why it is not holding Ohm's law? Because at that time, like potential is less and current is also. So why it is not holding Ohm's law?
That is what I am saying. The point is, Ohm's law will be holding good if it is going to determine the concentration or the bulk. But what we are measuring here is the concentration at the electrode surface. Concentration at the electrode surface is in equilibrium with the bulk. That is why we are equating the bulk concentration to the, but the rate determining step here is the electrode reaction. Because it has to be, the electrode reaction must be the rate determining. Then only electrochemistry can be used. So therefore, at the double layer, the as the supply of the ions are less, and when it is more, the current will be more. Current will be less. But if it is going to be the constant concentration very near to the electrode, then it will be Ohm's law. It will not be like that. As a function of time, the concentration at the electrode surface will be changing. As a function of time means as a function of potential. Because potential, we are varying the potential zero. Zero potential, even though concentration is there, no species will get reduced. Only at the reduction potential, the species will get reduced. When you have gone above the potential, all the species that is reducible will be reduced. Therefore, it is giving rise to limiting current. Okay, this is the curve we were talking about. So, therefore, you can see the working electrode is not yet capable of reducing cadmium ions, so residual current only flows through this. Whereas when you reach the current at the working electrode continue to rise as the electrode becomes more reducing and more cadmium ion around the electrode are being reduced, diffusion of cadmium ion does not limit the current yet. Only electrode becomes more and more reducing and cable or reducing cadmium 2 plus ions, current starts to be registered at the electrode. So all the cadmium ions are now around the electrode has already been reduced. Current of the electrode becomes limited by the diffusion rate of the cadmium 2 plus ion from the bulk of the solution to the electrode. The current stops rising and levels off at the plateau. Here the diffusion is what is controlling. Here the amount of the cadmium ions very near to the electrode is doing. And E half is the half the concentration. We will have time to talk about this, all these things again. We'll see that.
Okay.
Any other questions?
No.